64. Follow along.
Down in the valley with my Savior I would go, where the flowers are blooming and the sweet waters flow. Everywhere He leads me, I will follow, follow on, walking in His footsteps till the crown be won. Follow, follow, I will follow Jesus. Anywhere, everywhere, I will follow on. Follow, follow, I will follow Jesus. Everywhere He leads me, I will follow on. Down in the valley with my Savior I would go, where the storms are sweeping and the dark waters flow. With His hands you lead me, I will never, never fear. Danger cannot frighten me if my Lord is
given.
Beside my Savior would my soul ever keep. He will lead me safely in the path that He has trod, up to where they gather on the hills of God. Follow, follow, I would follow Jesus. Anywhere, everywhere, I will follow on.
Jason, would you pray? Pray for Joy, pray for services.
Dear Lord, thank You for an opportunity we have to gather together in church and once again, Lord, here preaching and teaching from Your Word. Lord, there are so many people that are sick dealing with cancer and health issues, and Lord, we think of Tom and Joy and Chip and Reen, and as well as some of the others, Lord, that are going through serious stuff, Lord, and we ask that You reach down and touch them, Lord. Be with them. Keep their spirits up, Lord. Mm-hmm. Like Pastor said earlier, give the doctors wisdom and the decisions that they make, Lord. And help people not to suffer, Lord. Lord, I ask that You be with the service today, Lord. Help each and every one of us to get a blessing out of it. And Lord, I ask that You be with our country today and our leaders, Lord, that You be with the decisions that they make, Lord. And Lord, every day we see more and more stuff happening, and this world is such a wicked place, Lord. We just ask that You keep us safe and faithful until You return, Lord. We ask all this in Your name. Amen.
Amen. You maybe see this. In Sunday school, we went over 1 Peter, and it's about suffering. But the important thing about suffering is, before Peter really gets into suffering, he gives you assurance of salvation and eternal security in the beginning of that book, to give you the assurance that even though you may go through some tough times, God is there. He knows. He knows what you're going through. And when He hath tried me, I shall come forth as gold. If we go into these trials and say, God, how can You get the glory out of this? What are You trying to teach me? Hey, guess what? The Lord's going to teach you some lessons. All right, I'm going to shut up. I'm not done yet. I put the May prayer list out. So get the prayer list. Pray over these if you would. Got all your elected officials on here. Got all your missionaries and your different prayer requests. And then our May devotionals are out there too on the table that's out there. Take a look at Brother Rader's table. Make sure you get a prayer card. And I will shut up. Brother, you come on up here and we'll turn that on whenever you're ready.
Thank you, Pastor.
Yes, sir.
Good morning.
Good morning.
Good to finally be here. As Pastor said, we've been on the schedule for a while, so it's good to be here at last. I'll introduce my family real quick so I have all of them stand up. I guess I better introduce myself first, huh? So I'm Nate Rader. The Rader name may sound familiar to you. Pastor Rader is my uncle.
And I'm sorry. It's,
And Bud Rader, I don't know if you guys are familiar with him. Some of you are, and he's my dad. All right, well, so my wife, Emmy, you guys turn around so everybody can see you. Then Brianna, our only girl. She is how old? 11. And then Phil, I almost forgot her age. And then Philip, he's 9. 9, right? Okay. That's a trouble. And then Martin. Martin's the only American-born child we have. And so he's 6. And then Logan and Luca, they're both 5. You guys can take a seat. So Martin was born on our first furlough, which has been about 7 years ago. We took a 7-year term. That's wow. kind of long. Well, COVID kind of played into that a little bit. But anyways, good to be here. Why don't you guys come up, Remy and Philip and Bree Bree. We're going to sing a song. I'm going to do a lot of talk, so don't worry. Or maybe you are worried. Yeah. That's just 3 hours. Okay. So what we're going to do, thank you, Brother Chuck, for letting us.
This is a good time.
Appreciate it. It's tuned, right?
Yes.
Oh, there you are, over there. I'm sorry. You looked at the wrong guy. All right, what we're going to do is we're going to sing a song in Spanish, give you a feel of what the music is like in the churches in Bolivia. And don't worry, I am going to translate it. If you would go to Psalm 145, we sing a lot of psalms in Bolivia. And the reason why we sing psalms, and we do sing some hymns, is because most people don't know how to read music. And so we're trying to go into the trend of learning to read music and having hymn books. Well, I've been surprised here in America where people are going away from that. We have like the opposite effect.
Right.
So because of that, we have to teach people basic choruses. And what better than the Psalms?
Right.
So Psalm 145, we're going to sing verses 1 through 3. And in Spanish, the title would be Te exaltaré mi Dios, mi Rey, which in English would be I will exalt thee, my God, my King. It's real brief, and I better make sure I'm on the right note. That's fine, but I do want you to pay a little bit of attention to what's going on in this video. It's 7 minutes, so I hope it's not too long for you. About the middle of the video, you're going to see a kind of like a little brick construction right on a corner street. And we're right, the church is right in the middle of the town. So when you see that, that's the church building under construction. Okay, and then the next picture over is going to show the same spot, only it's going to be a white building. So that's got the before and after picture of when it was built and when it was finished. That's the church building. Towards the end of the video, I'm actually stopped talking or narrating it. The music is going to turn into an Andean style music. By the way, that's kind of the typical music we have in Bolivia. When it does that, there's going to be a drone footage. Now, one of my brother-in-law is also a missionary in Bolivia. He's all into drones, and I appreciate it because he did this footage for us. So that, this is going to give you a good figure or good image of what our town looks like, okay? So I do envy a lot of places here in America. We have flat streets. Well, we don't have it in our town. We're on a slant on the side of a mountain. So pay attention to that. I think you'll appreciate it a little bit more. At the very end of that drone footage, though, there will the drone's going to do a flyover a blue-roofed house, and that's our house. So.
Discipleship of new believers. continue to serve the Lord in these specific areas: church planting, school ministries, Bible Institute, personal evangelism, and discipleship.
Is that good? Okay, well, I hope that gives you a little better view of our area, of Bolivia. There's a lot to talk about, a lot to share on this, and I will try to do that. I guess I'm not going to really preach this morning. I'm going to give you more of a testimonial of how things kind of got started in Bolivia. So if you would go to the Book of Acts real quick. Book of Acts, chapter 16. The title for this morning is, Are You Listening to the Holy Spirit? Are you paying attention? Are you listening? Acts chapter 16, and we're going to look at a real well-known piece of scripture, verses 5 through 10. You may even have this memorized. I almost do. Really, it's been a huge blessing in my life. But Acts chapter 16, verses 5 through 10. And I guess before we read... Well, one of the things that we really emphasize in missions in Bolivia, I know different missionaries do things differently, and that's perfectly fine, well, as long as they're doctrinally sound. One of the things that we really push for, and I believe that's happening even right here in Drummond Island, is we push the established churches that are 100% independent from man. Independent, I mean, dependent on God, but independent from man. And so when we were getting ready to buy a piece of land for the church building, now, I hope you notice the church. Just a real small building, but it was God's provision. But we were getting ready to search, you know, praying God would provide the funds. We taught the people that they need to learn how to tithe. They need to learn how to give their offerings. And so one of the men actually said, hey, Brother Nate, why don't you just call the churches and the cities and ask them to send the money? I said, no, that's not the way we do things here. You guys have to learn to give you as a church. Yeah. And so they learned how to do that. They still have a long ways to go still, I think. But they bought their own lot.
Amen.
They purchased it. And when they that excited them when they did that. And then once that was purchased, we were able to save up a little more money. And then we were able to start building. And they put 100% of the money down for the building itself. Now again, it's a real small construction, but it was God's provision.
Right.
It was all said and done. They could look back and say, hey, look what God did through us.
Right.
You know, as there was, it's not vainglory, but look what God did.
Yeah.
He used us as an instrument, and that was encouraging. And we're at the stage right now where the church is almost ready to take on its pastor. We've actually, I've talked to several men that are going into ministry. Nobody's interested. I mentioned the video. The reason is because there's not too many economic opportunities out in the country. Kind of the mindset in Bolivia, they don't see it as much here in America. But in the city, that's where you make the money. You go to Santa Cruz, Bolivia, one of Bolivia's major cities. Actually, Santa Cruz is the economic powerhouse of Bolivia. So when you go to Santa Cruz, it's pretty modern. It's not as modern as Detroit or, well, maybe Detroit isn't so modern.
Yeah.
But one of the big major cities of the U.S. But for Bolivia and for South America, it's one of the most growing cities in Latin America right now, the city of Santa Cruz, Bolivia. But as soon as you step out of the city, it's poverty. As soon as you step out, there's poverty in the cities too. But it's worse when you step out into the country. And so people look at that and think, well, if I go to the country, I'm not going to prosper. So they all want to go to the city. So that's kind of a sad thing. So we've taken a different approach in missions, and that is to try, I mean, we're praying about this, but I've been discipling two men with the hope that God would call one of them to pastor the church right there in Pucará. The name of the town, I guess I didn't say this, is Pucará. P-U-C-A-R-A, Pucará. It's a Quechua word meaning fortress. Now, there's a lot of history behind all this, but not enough time. But the town of Pucará was actually settled originally by the Spanish conquistadores. This was late 15, early 1600s. And then later, it actually settled in this area because it was strategically placed, because it's an easy place of defense. As you probably noticed, it's on a slant. There's actually cliffs, you didn't see this, but there's cliffs on different angles of the area, which makes it difficult for the enemy to just to come in and take over. And so what they were protected there, there was a good place because they could fight off the Inca Empire and the Guarani tribes. And so it's kind of a whole battle zone, this whole area. But anyway, later on in history, a lot of Spanish came in and settled the whole area. And one of the Spanish groups that settled our town specifically were Spanish Jews. And there's a lot of interesting things about that as well. We're not going to get into that right now. So there's a lot of history. But anyways, let's go to Acts chapter 16. And before I read, two last things. Number one, Pastor mentioned looking at our table. Take our prayer card, pray for us. That's the greatest thing you can do for any missionary, prayer.
That's right.
I think you guys know that.
Mm-hmm.
And secondly, if you're interested in getting our updates, we don't have postal service in Bolivia. But we do monthly updates via email. Sign up, there's a sign-up sheet, sign up. And I will get that on a monthly basis. And also, just one last thing. Brother Jim Hammond, he talked very, very highly of you guys. I got the opportunity to work with him a little bit last summer at Fundamental. And he loves you guys. Yeah. And I think he'd love to be here today if he could. But he bragged about your building and what you guys are doing right here. And he wasn't exaggerating. Praise God for what you guys are doing right here. All right, Acts chapter 16. Verses 5 says, and so were the churches established in the faith and increased in number daily. And I think we understand that at this period of time, something miraculous was happening. All missionaries, all apostles were pioneers. There was not a single apostle that was not a pioneer. They were the first ones everywhere to preach the gospel. This was big stuff. It was big news. And so as they were going through out the world and preaching, something miraculous is happening. The people are getting saved. And not only is there salvation, not only is it visible, but there's churches springing up all over the place. And it's happening at a rapid pace. You guys probably know, if you go, we're not going to do it, but early chapters of Acts, the first church, the first day, how many people were saved? 3,000 were added. 3,000 were saved. And that was just continually happening throughout the modern world. And so it says that where the church is established in the faith and increase in number daily. Let's pray before we continue. Lord Jesus, we thank you for your word. Lord, you know I'm talking a little bit quick because there's a lot to talk about. But Lord, I ask that this morning, what we're going to look at would be an encouragement to us. Use your word in our life today. Help us to be willing to obey you. Help us to be willing. I pray this in Jesus' name. Amen.
Amen.
So verse 6 says, now when they had gone through a Phrygia in the region of Galatia, now they're going from city to province, and it says that, and were forbidden of the Holy Ghost to preach the word in Asia. Now they had, now Paul had he had a goal. He's going throughout Asia Minor, and now he's focused on mainland Asia. Now Asia was a little bit different back then. Okay, the borders were all a little bit different. The population was way different. But he knew this, he wanted to go to this mystical land. I'm pretty sure he didn't know the languages. But you know, the Holy Spirit was gonna guide him through this. They believed he was, at least. And so they're gonna go into Asia, and the Holy Spirit turned them around. We don't know how he did it, but he said, no, you're not gonna go into Asia. Maybe it was a vision. Maybe he spoke to them in an audible voice. We don't really know. Maybe God sent an angel. But it does say that the Holy Spirit suffered them not. He told them that they were forbidden of the Holy Spirit to not go. And then verse 7, they changed directions. Okay, Holy Spirit, we understand. Actually, we don't understand, but we're going to obey. And so right. They turned directions, and they went into Mysia, a province. They say to go into Bithynia, but the Spirit suffered them not. For the second consecutive time, the Holy Spirit told them no. Now, I don't know if they stopped along the way. It doesn't mention it here. Maybe they stopped along the way and preached. I'm sure they did. It doesn't mention it, but I'm sure they did in every opportunity that they had. But for whatever reason, the Holy Spirit, for the second time, made it very clear they were not to continue on. And that probably confused them. They're probably getting a little bit desperate. But they still obeyed. In verse 8, they passing by Mysia came down to, at that time, the ancient city of Troas. And a vision appeared to Paul in the night. There stood a man of Macedonia and prayed him, saying, come over to Macedonia and help us. And after he had seen the vision, immediately we endeavored to go into Macedonia, assuredly gathering that the Lord had called us for to preach the gospel unto them. Now, I think you probably know your biblical, your church history, how the gospel spread through all of Macedonia, Greece, Europe, and eventually into America. All of that happened because of the obedience of this little group.
That's right.
Paul, Silas, Timothy, possibly a few other people. I think we all understand that at this period of time, people usually travel in caravans and for logical reasons. I know I can't utter the voice of the man in verse 9, but this man was desperate. And a vision appeared to Paul in the night. This man was in great distress as he begged for them to come to Macedonia and help us. Now this wasn't, now we understand, this wasn't a message sent by a messenger, right? This was not Facebook, Twitter, or whatever you want to throw out there. It wasn't a phone call. It was a vision to Paul. Now it doesn't say, in verse 10, it doesn't say that they went the next day specifically, but they did endeavor, immediately they endeavored, they pursued to go into Macedonia. A little bit about that, I don't know how much understanding we have about traveling at this period of time. I think we also understand that from Troas to Macedonia, this is a gulf that they have to cross. And there's certain times of the year where you can't cross it because the storms, the winter storms. And so I think the Holy Spirit had this perfectly aligned for them to travel the next day. I do think that happened. But you know, this takes me back to Bolivia a little bit because we don't have a gulf in Bolivia. We don't have ocean. We're landlocked. But one thing that is quite similar to this is that there's certain times of the year where it's difficult to travel. And that's because of the rain. We have two seasons in Bolivia. We have dry and wet. Wet season is summertime, dry season is wintertime. So we have those two basic seasons. We don't really have, you don't see spring and you don't see fall. Those are basically unknown. But in the summertime, in the rainy season, the roads, you saw the roads, sometimes they're so sloppy, you can't go from point A to point B. The town where we live is about an hour and a half from the nearest village or town that has a grocery store. So we have to travel. Anytime we go to get groceries, we have to plan our trip out. God bless us with a vehicle. And so a lot of people don't have vehicles. So they got to get on a bus to go from point A to point B. And you know, when Emmy and I were first married, we didn't have a vehicle. We had a motorcycle. But before we got a motorcycle, we had to get on the bus to go from our town to the next town. And in the rainy season, you have to stand on a street corner and wait for that bus to come through. So there's no bus that actually leaves from our town. Well, our town is kind of a, it just passes right through our town. So you have to stop on the stand on the street corner and wait for the bus. You have to flag them down when they come through. Well, sometimes the bus is so full, you can't get on. So you have to, and when I say full, I don't mean the seats are full. I mean the seats and the aisles are full. And we haven't had it in our town, but in the city, The smaller buses, you have people hanging out the doors and holding on for dear life. We don't have, it's not quite that extreme in our town. But sometimes there's no room. And then there's times of the year when the rainy seasons hit, where the bus will get stuck down the road, and he's stuck down there for 2 to 3 days. And so you can't go. You can't go anywhere. And so that, you know, thinking about what happens in Bolivia gives me a better understanding of what happened to Paul and Silas. They immediately endeavored to go to Macedonia. Now, the question that hits me is, what would have happened if Paul would have continued on anyways? What would have happened if they would have gone to Asia? What would have happened if they would have said, okay, Lord, we're going to obey and not go to Asia, but we're definitely going to Bithynia? Mm-hmm. I don't think we can answer that question. Mm-hmm. Now, I hope, let's go to 1 Peter. Pastor talked about this morning. 1 Peter chapter 1. I'm just going to just mention it real quick. Asia and Bithynia were not forgotten to God. They were not.
None.
Later on, men went and preached. It says here, 1 Peter chapter 1, Peter, an apostle of Jesus Christ, to the strangers scattered throughout Pontus, Galatia, Cappadocia, and there's those two names, Asia and Bithynia. Peter went to Asia and Bithynia. They were not forgotten. Later on, yes, it didn't happen according to the plan of Paul, but they did go eventually. And the gospel was preached to these people. Now, years ago when I was just a kid, actually before I was even born, there was a man by the name of Angel Carrion. Angel was a Catholic priest. And as a Catholic priest, he worked in the church in the town of Mojocoya. And Mojocoya is about a 10 to 12 hour drive from our place. And I'm going to make this real quick because there's a long story behind this. But Brother Ankin in English is translated angel. Now that's an uncommon male name here in the U.S. But angel, he started to do something that priests normally don't do. And that is simply reading the Bible. Mm-hmm. Priests don't read the Bible. Did you know that? They might read a few verses, but they'll read the Bible as a whole. So he read the Bible. And he liked it. And so he read it a second time. On that second read-through, he ended up getting saved. This took about 2 years to go through, okay? But he got saved on that second time reading through the Bible. And then in this new excitement, this new birth, he didn't know what to call it. He shared this excitement with his fellow priests, and he led 9 of them to the Lord.
Amen.
And of course, the Catholic Church got a hold of it and realized what was going on. So these men got excommunicated, which was a good thing, right? And so in this excommunication, he left the town of Mojocoya and went to one of Bolivia's major cities called Cochabamba. Cochabamba at that time had about 1.5 million people. And his 35 years of pastor, he ended up becoming a Baptist pastor. In his 35 years of pastoring, he was able to establish 5 churches in the city of Cochabamba.
Yeah.
But he was always burdened for the town of Mojocoya. God never allowed him to go to Mojocoya. It never made sense why God would not let him go. But that's the way it worked out. Well, one year, he was holding a conference at his church, and my dad went. And as my dad met and got to meet Brother Angel, Pastor Angel, he shared this burden with my dad. And there's something about being a pioneer as a missionary that excites us. It is not about getting a big name, but we love the fact to be the first ones to push the gospel into an unknown area.
Right. Right.
Kind of like Paul, kind of like Peter. And so he shared this with my dad. That excited my dad. He wanted to go to Mojocoya tomorrow if he could. So my dad started praying about it. I only could pray for about 20 years before he shared this with my dad. My dad prayed for another 13 years. And in 2003, this is 1990. In 2003, it seemed like God gave the green light to go to Mojocoya. And so my dad formed this little missionary group to go to Mojocoya. It was in the group we had my dad, another missionary, Doug Scott. There were 3 Bob Jones University students that were visiting us at the time. There were 2 Bolivian Bible College students, a Bolivian national pastor, and myself and one of my siblings. And so we made this trip that was going to be kind of a long trip to Mojocoya. Now, we didn't know this, but we were going to go through the town of Pucará, the town where we're at this time. And then And from, so where I grew up, the town of Valle Grande, if you can't hardly picture a map in your head, in Central South America, we were going from north to southwest. That's kind of the direction we took. So from the town of Valle Grande, where I grew up, we had to go up the mountain and come to the town of Pucará, and then back down the mountain to the community called El Oro. I mentioned El Oro in the presentation. And so we went down to the mountain through the town of El Oro, at the bottom of a river. And then you go back up the mountain again, way up, about 10,000 feet above sea level. And then you come to the place called Nuevo Mundo, which is called, or in English is New World. And then we came through a little community, it's a real small community that was called Tipal. Tipal, in a nutshell, had a little church started because some guy dropped a bunch of gospel tracts in an airplane. Now some of you guys are familiar with my dad. He had an aviation program that's no longer in existence because the government shut that down. Well, my dad turns out was a guy that flew over and dropped the gospel tracts. The kids at the school got a hold of the gospel tracts and gave them to the parents. And many got saved. They didn't know what to call what they were doing, but they started their own church.
Amen.
And again, they didn't know what they were doing. They didn't know what to call it, a service or a church. They had no idea. But they started a church. Interesting how the Holy Spirit works.
Right.
Yeah. Even without knowing the terms, yeah, the terminology. And that goes to prove how God can use a gospel tract. You have no idea what God is capable to do with His word, His gospel tracts. Anyways, so we were encouraged through these people. They encouraged us. Probably more than we encouraged them. And then we continued our trip to Mohocoya. And a series of events happened. I can't explain all what happened. But God told us, no, you're not continuing your trip. Which was confusing. 20 plus years of prayer from Angel Carrion. 13 years of prayer from my dad. And now the Holy Spirit says no. You know, my dad and Brother Doug, or Missionary Doug, they were heartbroken. So we prayed over that decision overnight. The next day we turned around and we headed back. And actually both the vehicles broke down, so we had to stay another night to get those vehicles fixed. Our return trip, we stayed on a soccer field in the town of Nuevo Mundo, which is New World. That's at 10,000 feet above sea level. Well, we put out our tents on the soccer field, we stayed the night. It was kind of cold that night. And we got up early the next morning. The sun was just peeking over the mountains. And we were surrounded by all these kids, which kind of frightened us a little bit at first. And then we what are we going to do? We played a soccer game with these kids. They like that. And then the ladies did a little Bible study with the kids. And that was a lot of fun. We continued our trip. We came down the mountain. And we stopped in a community called El Oro. We made some visits. People were busy. People were working. This community specifically, their main product, I guess, or main, what they grow the most is sugarcane. So they squeeze sugarcane, they sell the sugar and the juice. And so we had a lot of sugarcane juice to drink that day. And that was a little bit sickening sweet, you could say. But it was enjoyable at the same time, just making the visits. We thought nobody's going to come to church because we were going to hold a little service. We thought nobody's going to show up because, well, people were working. And over half the community showed up that day.
Amen.
And three men got saved. Amen. And that was the beginning of that little church. Now, I mentioned that in the presentation that we were able to play a heavy role in the establishing of this church. But we were able to, I mentioned that in the video where they have a partial pastor. This video was made a year ago, okay? So now they have a full-time pastor. A lot changed in 1 year. And so it's amazing what God has done in that little community. We continued up the mountain, 5,800 feet above this little community of El Oro. And we came to the town called Pucará, Fortress, in Quechua, Fortress, Pucará. We didn't make any kind of a service or do a service that day, but we did make some visits. And that was also the beginning of Fortress Baptist Church. Now, I mentioned in the video that there was a missionary family there before us. Devin and Jenny Dawson. Maybe some of you have met them. They're actually from Community Baptist, but they're with our mission here, Baptist Pioneer Mission. Well, they played a huge role in the establishing of this church. When Emmy and I were brand new missionaries on the field, God, we were trying to follow God's leading, where He wanted us to go specifically. And there's doors open all over the place. But Brother Devin, he talked to us and said, hey, Nate, we're getting ready to go back on furlough. Why don't you come take our place for a year? And then, you know, maybe God will lead you where to go after that. So we did that. We prayed about it. We felt that was the thing to do. That's what we did. And so my dad was working with us at that time as well. Well, this would have been 2009. Devin and Jenny went in 2006. That trip that I mentioned about Mohokoya trip, that was in 2003. So 3 years passed between the first visit and when the Dawsons arrived on the scene in the town of Pucará. Well, in that 2000 mark period, just before they left on furlough, they were able to baptize the first members of the church. So the church was had its first members that night, that Sunday night that the members signed the book. So the first members were added that night to the church. And that very same night, the church or the members decided on their name. And what a better name than Fortress, since the name is Fortress. Fortress Baptist Church. The Dawsons came to the States. They were on furlough for that full year. And during that time, Emmy and I were doing survey trips, see where God would lead us. And we just felt that God was closing the door again and again and again. Didn't make any sense to us. Why would God not allow us to go to that town that has a need? It made no sense. And then at the same time, we were using their house, their things. And so we were praying about, you know, start buying furniture. Because we needed, we needed things to furnish our house. And God again would close the door on our purchases. Well, the day he came, well, Devin and Jenny came back. They were in Bolivia for about a week. And Devin called Emmy and I up and said, hey, Nate and Emmy, why don't you guys have this little meeting. So we did. And they told us how God was leading them to come back to the States and pastor a church. Now, before Devin got to the point where he's going to ask us to pray about continuing in Pucará, I already knew God answered our prayer.
Yeah.
I mean, it was obvious. We never considered Pucará. It never came to mind to us. But we knew God had already answered our prayer. Now, we did pray about it before. We said yes, right? But God just opened that door wide open. And so that in a nutshell, I know I'm skipping so much about what I'm trying to say here. But the situation of our trip to Mohokoya was so similar to this. We wanted to go to Mohokoya. We were burdened to go to Mohokoya. And the Holy Spirit said no. Now I have to ask myself, would the church of El Oro, would it have been established if we would have gone on to Mohokoya? Would the work or the church in Pucará have ever been established if we would have gone on to Mohokoya? I don't know. I don't know the answer to that. And to this day, as far as we understand, nobody's ever gone to Mohokoya, to this day. So we're still praying about it. It's a big town, 7,000 people. It could be there's a church there. We really don't know. But what would have happened if those missionaries would have been stubborn and would have said, Lord, we're going anyways. It doesn't matter. Here's a little piece of a little story of what happened, part of what happened on that trip. One of the missionaries had his pickup truck. He had a Toyota Tacoma, one of the older versions. As we're going down these rough roads, the main leaf spring broke on the back end of it. And so that national pastor that I mentioned, this guy, he knows the woods really well. So he says, I know how to fix this thing. So he grabbed a machete, and he cut a tree, as a very specific tree. He cut out down a branch about this long, about this thick. And we don't have duct tape in Bolivia, but we do have inner tube. And so that's the Bolivian version of a duct tape. So he put it on that leaf spring, and he just wound that thing up with rubber. That missionary drove that pickup truck with that very same piece of wood for 9 years. And he sold it with it on there. I hope he told the new buyer that. I don't know. I think he probably did. And that was really cool to see how, you know, nature itself can fix a pickup truck. You have no idea what God can do through nature. But anyways, in a nutshell, that's kind of what happened through this story, what happened. You know what? The church is doing very well. We've been blessed with technology, haven't we?
Amen.
But it's been a stumbling block, too.
Right.
I remember when Ann and I first moved to the town of Pucará, running water was a new thing. So when we arrived, they already had running water. Before that, they had to go to a creek down the road, and they had to call stuff in buckets, you know. So that was a blessing. It was a new thing for them. But they didn't have electricity, which, you know, you live with what you have. So it was normal for us to have a candle or a gas lamp. In church, we have a gas lamp. Very noisy. When you turn on a gas lamp, I don't know if there's a difference between the gas lamps. They're American-made versus Bolivian. But they make a really loud whistling sound. And so you got to play with the heat there for until you tune it out. And so that was always kind of an interesting situation. And they put out a lot of heat as well. But anyways, we didn't have electricity. Soon after, we had electricity. And like a month after we had electricity, it's like it seemed like everybody bought TV, DVD players, and people stopped going to church. And we're thinking, what's going on with people? Well, it turns out that they all wanted to stay home and watch TV, because it was a new thing. Well, that got old pretty quick, and people came back to church. And then cell phones came onto the scene. But let me make a real quick pause. Before we had technology or electricity, people were very receptive to the gospel. When technology came in, and it was a blessing, don't get me wrong, it was a blessing, people became hardened towards the gospel.
Right.
It's hard to explain, really, but it just seems like people have a sense of independence. It seems that way, at least. Well, years later, COVID hit. And of course, we probably know the whole story about COVID. And when COVID hit, it, in a way, it became a blessing. I know we all have people, loved ones, that die from it. It's a terrible situation, but on the spiritual side of things, I think it was a blessing. Mm-hmm. We had almost an awakening in our town because people realized how fragile they really are.
Yeah.
You know, God knows how to use this different situations in our life. Mm-hmm. He knows how to use those for His glory.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. We were prohibited to have any kind of service at all for the next 8 months in our town. And there's a lot of things I can tell you about that, but one thing is that we actually never really stopped having service. We had service at our home. Everybody was invited. Come on over. It was illegal, but so what? Come on
Amen.
Over. And we thought that, we were wondering what the day was going to come where we were going to have a fine or jail time. That wasn't a problem, but a fine possibly. Well, that never happened. Mm-hmm. Well, as the weeks went on, our crowd grew bigger and bigger and bigger. We thought, you know what? We have to get back to church, the church building. And so we did that. And the local government, they never said no. They gave us full permission to go back, as long as we wore the mask, and that was annoying, but we were able to go back to church. So God used, I believe, for His glory.
Yeah.
And people are aware of how weak we really are as human beings. I guess the question I asked this morning is simply this. Are we paying attention to the guidance of the Holy Spirit? I know there's so much more we can talk about. And we go from point to point of how to listen to His guidance. But are we listening attentively to His guidance? Again, what would have happened if Paul in Acts chapter 16 would have said, Lord, we're going to Asia. We don't know. I don't think we could ever answer that question. What would have happened if missionary Bud and Doug Scott would have said, Lord, we're going to Mohokoya. What would have happened? We don't know. I don't think we can answer that. But because of that, we do know the results. They've been magnificent. God has been honored through the results of the obedience of these men and women. Are we listening to the guidance of the Holy Spirit? You may say, Brother Nate, how can I follow His guidance? I don't know what His will is for my life. You know, I've been asked multiple times by young folks more than anything else, and Brother Nate, how can I know God's will for my life? And there's a whole different sermon, but do you know the Bible seven times says this is the will of God? Seven times. And my answer is always the same. Are you obeying those seven areas? If you're not, how is He going to guide you into deeper understanding or to a little more, He's a little more complicated.
Right.
But He's not. Yeah. We have to obey the simple things first. Mm-hmm. The same thing applies to the guidance of the Holy Spirit. Are we listening to Him attentively? Are we paying attention to His calling? And we're going to close up now, but if you would go to, I believe it's Hebrews chapter 13. Hebrews chapter 13. I mentioned the presentation that we had an invitation given from a man from the community called Huertas. Huertas means orchards. In Bolivia, they're pretty literal with their names. Pucará means fortress, and that's what it was, a fort. There's never any kind of walls. But just the location made a good place of defense. Huertas, again, means orchards. And as you can imagine, that's what they are. It's a place full of orchards. The town that I mentioned before, El Oro, means the gold. And there's never gold there, but there's a lot of fool's gold. And so there's people that are, you know, they'll crack open a rocket. I'm rich. And of course, that's not what they thought it was. So they're pretty literal with their names. So I got an invitation during the pandemic when we were shut down. I had an invitation from a man from the community of Huertas. He said, Brother Nate, we need a church in our community. Now, when I say community, I'm talking about from this house, it takes a half hour walk to the next house. Okay, there's no town hall. So everything just kind of spread out all over the place. But we haven't been able to go. We've been in lockdown. I really haven't felt that God has led us to go yet as well. So we're praying about that, praying for the community or about going to the community of Huertas. And another town that has a great need, it's actually pretty close to us, is called Alto Seco. I mentioned that as well, which means high and dry. And again, it's high and dry. And they're pretty literal. And they have not invited us, but there's nothing going on in this little town. So as we're focusing in our town of Pucará, establishing Fortress Baptist Church, and pray that God would provide a pastor. We're trying to spread out a little bit more. I mentioned before that we're involved with schools, camps, church planting. Church planting is our main focus. And then with the Bible Institute, I think I already mentioned that, but also discipleship, which is a big part of our ministry, discipleship. It's a blessing, but it takes so much time to disciple people. Sometimes the guys that I'm discipling, and sometimes I go out and I work with them in the field. And just to give them the sense that I'm real just like them. I sweat like them. I get tired just like them. And it gives me the opportunity to show them of how I react in a bad situation. You know? That's part of discipleship. You can see that in the life of Jesus. But we're also involved with, and this will probably be the main focus of everything, personal evangelism. Now, personal evangelism is different, I think, a little bit in Bolivia as what it is here in America. Here in America, door knocking works great. In Bolivia, door knocking does not work. People are very resistant to door knocking. They don't like that. There's so many religions in Bolivia, they don't want to know about it. What we have to do is establish a friendship, and then the doors open. The problem is, it takes time. It's not quick. Okay, go back. Go to Hebrews chapter 13. I'm going off on a rabbit trail right now. But
they're used to it.
Hebrews chapter 13, verses 20 through 21. It says, now the God of peace that brought again from the dead our Lord Jesus, that great shepherd, and he is great, that great shepherd. That great shepherd of the sheep through the blood of the everlasting covenant. And there's no other way, I think we understand, there's no other way but through Jesus Christ. And verse 21, but make you perfect in every good work to do his will, working in you that which is well-pleasing in his sight, through Jesus Christ, to whom be glory forever and ever. Amen. Do you know that God has a perfect work that he wants to do in you?
That's right.
Did you know that? It says it right here, verse 21, make you perfect. Doesn't make you literally perfect. We're not going to be perfect until we see him, right? But we're able to do his perfect will. So to make you perfect in every good work, to do his will. And that only happens through the guidance of the Holy Spirit. Amen. We have to be attentive. We have to be paying attention to his guidance. But how do we do that? How do we pay attention to his guidance? How are we able to do his perfect will? It's simple. Looking unto him.
That's right.
Looking unto him. I heard a sermon from a Bible college student that was a new student at the time, but was going into, he was going through preaching classes. And he preached this very strange sermon. And it was titled, Looking to Your Pastor. And he never mentioned about looking unto Jesus, the author and finisher. He said, looking unto your pastor. And that didn't come across very well. Because the Bible doesn't say that. It said, looking unto Jesus.
Right.
Looking unto him. That's the way we're attentive to the calling of the Holy Spirit. That's how Paul knew that God was leading him in a whole different direction. It wasn't to Asia. It wasn't to Bithynia. But it was to another place because he was attentive He was paying attention. Now we know that everybody's situation is different. Everybody's unique. And he guided you maybe in a different way. But are you paying attention? Pastor mentioned this morning in Sunday school. Not everybody's called to be a preacher. Not everybody's called to be a missionary, to be a pastor. But he wants everybody to be willing.
Yeah.
Willing.
That's right.
Are you willing to go? You know, just being back, coming back to the U.S. compared to 7 years ago when we were here last time, America has become a darker country.
That's right.
It's amazing what has happened in 7 years. What's going to happen in the next 4 to 5 years or 6 or 7 years? I don't know.
Yeah.
But it has become a mission field. It always has been. It's become even more a mission field than it was 7 years ago. God can use you right here in America. But the question still stands. Are you listening to his guidance? Are you willing to obey his perfect will in your life? You might say, well, Brother Nate, I'm not capable. Yes, you are. God made Moses capable. He made David capable. He made Daniel capable. He can make you capable. God made Pastor capable. Anybody's capable if you're just willing.
That's right.
Let's pray. Heavenly Father, we thank you for your word. Lord, I know there's so much more we could say. But Lord, we thank you for being good to us. Thank you for the guidance and for the leading that Paul did. Thank you that he was submissive to you. Thank you, Lord, for what you did through his life. Thank you what you've done through the lives of countless missionaries across the world and across time. Thank you, Lord, for what's being done around the world right now. And Lord, we thank you for the church right here in Durban Island. Will you use them in a mighty way? Bless them. Bless Pastor and their family. And Lord, I ask that you would be able to provide the funds to be able to fully establish or actually to fully finish the building right here. Let this church be a lighthouse in this area of the world. Thank you, Lord, for your goodness. Help us to be willing. I pray this in Jesus' name. Amen.
Amen.
Thank you, Pastor.